Hello everybody, welcome back. Today in this video, I want to go over some changes to, of course, the LED matrix control software, but I kind of just want to show you guys some really cool speed improvements and other things that I've implemented. A lot of this stuff I've worked on, you know, maybe 3 or 4 days ago, right after my last video, but I haven't made a video about it until now because I wanted to be able to really show off some of these improvements. So this video is just going to kind of be about all that, and I'll show you some of the cool things that I've changed. First of all, there's not too much on the surface that's changed. I've worked a little bit on the UI, so I've added some icons here to some of these options, just because it makes it kind of a little easier to understand what's going on. And if you like sort of play with these enough and you work with the program enough, it gets really easy to just sort of look at the picture and see what button to click, that kind of thing. Yeah, and I've got these from Icons 8, and it should be legal for me to have these as long as like I put this link in my about page. I don't have an about page yet programmed in, so here's the placeholder. But anyways, yeah, you might have noticed a new option here for color mode. This is under serial because this really only matters, from serial onward. It doesn't matter on this preview or anything. But you'll notice there's 24 bits per pixel, 16 and 8 bits per pixel modes. And I'll show you what that means here. So if we pull up the, just kind of make this a little bigger. If we pull up this right here, this is of course the serial protocol. And you saw this in the last video. This right here, the definition request, this hasn't changed, but this has. So we now have a 24 bit per pixel, 16 and 8 mode. Really the only thing that's changed on 24 bits per pixel is the header byte. So it's 0x11. I think it was, actually it might have been that same last time, but that's what it is. And you can see, of course, this is unchanged. And this is, of course, 24 bits per pixel. And what that means is you can see here, like the first pixel example, one pixel has 24 bits. So there's 8 bits or 1 byte for each color. And that's really good because you get like 16 million different colors out of this, but it uses a lot of data. So there's obviously 1 byte for every pixel. And if you're running a huge display, like I'm about to show you, that can be a bit much, you know, quite a bit more data than you might actually need. So we have 16 bit per pixel mode, and you'll notice this is a little different. So here's a whole pixel, but it's only covering 2 bytes worth of data. And you'll notice that there's red data in the first byte, and there's also green data, but only part of it. The other part is in the second byte. So the most significant green bits end up in the red byte, and the least significant green bits end up in the blue byte. This is actually really pretty common. This is known as, in fact, there's like an actual name for it here, high color. So 24 bits per pixel is true color. This is high color. And I guess these were common way back in the day. I'm not old enough to have actually been around when these were common, but this is a standard thing. So you have 5 bits for red, 6 bits for green, and 5 for blue. The reason there's more for green is just that human eyes can see green shades better than anything, so there's more data given to green. Really, it doesn't matter too much. You could get away with like just using or leaving out this data and just having 555. This is also known as 565 data or color because you have 565. But anyways, it's really pretty simple. You just have to do some bit shifting to unpack this. Or it just depends on your implementation. But this is what the protocol is. So I guess, again, it's up to you to make your matrix work with this if you want it to. And then, of course, 8 bits per pixel. So this is just 1 byte for every pixel. And this is really bad quality color. You only have 3 bits for red, 3 for green, and only 2 for blue. The reason there's 3 for red and 3 for green instead of 2, I guess the reason blue gets the short end of the stick here is again, humanizer are better at picking out greens and then reds, but they're not so great at picking out blues. So this technically probably looks the best. It probably doesn't make that much of a difference in practice. But it is important to use all this data. I did try it with just two bites or two bits for red, two for green and two for blue, and it was really bad. But once I added this extra bit for the red and green, it actually, you know, colors somewhat looked a little bit better. So, and again, this isn't gonna look good really at all, but let me actually fix this. You can see that there's actually quite a bit less data. And that's really the reason you would use something like this, is every pixel now only takes up one byte, whereas in high color mode, every pixel takes up three bytes. So it's legit, you know, a third of the bandwidth. So you could run a display three times as big at the same frame rate, or, you know, a current display at three times the frame rate or whatever, if, of course, you're limited by your serial data transmission speed. But yeah, you'll notice the header byte for these are different. So we have 0, we have 1, 1, 1, 2, and 1, 3. So you'll need to account for that in your Arduino code. And of course, I'll have examples on the GitHub page. But again, going back to this, so I've got a display. It's actually running in 16-bit per color mode. The reason it's running in that is because this display physically can't display anything higher quality than that. So there's no need to send over true color when it's just going to be downsampled on the Arduino itself. So we'll put this to 16 bits per pixel. And I think it's plugged in. Yeah, so we'll connect to it here. And we'll click Start Capture. Now you may notice this is actually really pretty high resolution. You can't even really see the individual pixels. In fact, let me stop this. If I click, this will highlight just one pixel. So you can see the pixels on this are tiny. And the reason for that is this is 320 by 240 pixels. So there's a lot of information here. This is a really big matrix. And in fact, it's not a matrix. It is a LCD display. So I've got my phone here recording. So this isn't the optimal, I guess, setup here. But yeah, so you can see we have the full data running over here. Let me go ahead and switch, or I guess kind of adjust this window here so it matches the aspect ratio. This is a 4x3 display. So if I set it by 1080 by 1440, that's a 4x3 aspect ratio. And then I'm going to move this over to center it on my screen. But as you can see, the serial frames per second, we're getting 37, maybe like 40 frames a second. In fact, if I was actually to lower this down so we're just capturing pixel for pixel, we don't have to downsample, it'll actually run at about 70 frames a second. But yeah, going back to the display here, you can see how smooth everything is. It's running really quite well. I've got a little demo here. I'll pull up Powder Game and I will line this up exactly with the with the outline of the game here, and I'll display my outline. I'll shrink this down. This also might be a little demo of how you actually use the software, since I haven't really made a video about that. And we'll move this back over. Let's get a little pixel perfect alignment here. All right, yeah, that looks good. Okay, and then make sure whenever you're doing this display outline, turn that off because it slows everything down. All right, so here's my phone view again. If you notice any flickering, that's not there in real life. So just keep that in mind. But as you can see, everything is running really smoothly. If we kind of just play around with this Powder Game toy thing, you can see everything just works really, really well. And so, I mean, again, this could be displaying anything. This could be displaying a video. It could be displaying like here's a video game. So really it's pretty open. of course, with the software. And again, right now I do only have the display capture mode working. I actually have turned off the audio mode. That's what I'm going to work on next. I actually have actually somewhat implemented the drawing mode, if you look here, just as a test. You can see it's not quite up to standard. I'd like it, I guess. But anyways, that's kind of a lot of talking right now. I just want to keep this video really short and show you guys some of the updates. Again, if you guys have any questions, leave a comment. I'll be sure to read them and answer them. As always, the code is on GitHub. You can easily download the program under the releases page. I'm going to be releasing sort of maybe weekly alpha builds that are mostly stable. I've done a lot of work under the hood to make this more stable than it has been and more stable than previous versions of the software. And right now, you'd be pretty hard pressed to find, or to, I guess, to make it crash. I've got this screen recorder down pretty well. But that being said, a lot of the behind the scenes, like optimization and refactoring and everything, is done. So from here on out, like adding new modes, like adding the imaging and drawing modes and everything, it's going to be really easy. And I can probably copy and paste a lot of the code from the LED matrix control software 2, which was on WinForms, but it's all C#. So a lot of the methods and stuff will just copy right over. So anyways, that's it for this video. If you guys, again, if you have any questions, let me know and I'll be sure to answer them, and I'll see you guys in the next video.